Hey there, I'm Lee Ullman here with some big news from the National Young Farmers Coalition. We're partnering with Heritage Radio Network on a special season of The Farm Report. It's all about what's happening with the Farm Bill and how it impacts farmers and eaters.
I am growing diversified vegetables on land that's been in our family for 150 years.
And so with the pandemic, gentrification, property values going up, we had to sell the land and we lost it.
Join us as we uncover the untold stories behind this massive piece of legislation that shapes how we grow our food, what we eat, and so much more.
The problems we have had, those are things that come from earlier Farm Bill and USDA policy, right? Like Earl Butts, get big or get out.
You know, it's my responsibility to know not only what I'm eating, but then like how that all came to be and realize like, wow, like this piece of legislation, all this money, like it's technically something that I support as a taxpayer.
While Congress debates the next Farm Bill, this is not just an invitation to listen. It's a call to action. Be part of the conversation. Subscribe to the Farm Report on Heritage Radio Network, wherever you listen to podcasts.
You're listening to Heritage Radio Network. Since 2009, HRN podcasts have been exploring the wide world of food, beverage, and agriculture. Learn more at heritageradionetwork.org.
Help keep nonprofit food radio on the air and get a limited release HRN t-shirt designed by artist Chema Scandal. When you become an HRN member or renew your existing membership at the $90 level, you'll receive a shirt created exclusively for members as our thank you gift. Don't wait, because this limited edition t-shirt is only available until December 31st. Go to heritageradionetwork.org/donate to support HRN at any level. There's more swag and benefits available for any tax-deductible donation. You can even get your company on the HRN airwaves as a perk of our business membership program. Head to heritageradionetwork.org/donate.
We talk about food. We talk about music with musical dudes. Finger on the pulse, snacky tunes.
Hello and welcome to Snacky Tunes. I am one half your host, Darren Bresnitz. Congratulations to all the California restaurants who were recognized by the Michelin Guide this week, and to all the LA restaurants who made it onto the LA Times 101 restaurant list. It's great to see the community recognized, and if you want to check out some new spots or return to some old haunts, the holiday season is a great time to do this. Speaking of new restaurants, we are so excited to have Avish Naran, who is the restaurateur founder of Pijja Palace in Silver Lake. It is a new type of sports bar that we have yet to see that combines Italian food with Indian food in a very nice neighborhood spot. He talks about breaking the rules, his recent accolades, and how he hopes to redefine what the sports bar can be in the modern restaurant era. Then we hit the archives for a live in-studio performance by CJ Fly, rapper and founding member of the hip-hop collective Pro Era. So please sit back, relax, and enjoy Snacky Tunes here on Heritage Radio Network.
Check. Yo, yo. Was one of the happiest fellas when I first met Bella. We started off as just friends, then exchanged love letters, became best friends, and figured there was no one better. I told her we was gonna be homies forever. You're not the type that I would often meet. More from the magazine, not on the street. Feeling like the man, but she would walk with me. Her mom is a lawyer, her daddy a cop. Got another chick on the side, but I ain't scared of her pops. She don't talk about her family a lot. When I'm with her, she love to stare at her watch. I connected the dots, third eye squinting, cause I'm trying to see things through. Figured out what we gonna do. Kinda hungry, let's go eat some food. To Little Italy, her family spot. I'm trying to change my diet so I won't be having a lot. And older head said when you go to sit facing the door, so you can gaze at the floor in case of breaking the war. We walked in, they sat us down pronto. Had a short convo, and even I know not to hurt my Italiano. She told me, get her a drink and be ready for this. I said, what? Her dad popped up and started asking for a wedding and said, let me know when I got a reverend friend. It's either you get her a ring or we
in a ring.
Her brother asked me if I wanted a slice. I told him one would be nice. I sat there hoping he ain't come with his knife. I'm in a love triangle. How did I get into this love triangle? Love triangle. Fuck it, don't give a shit. I'm infamous for having shit.
Fly.
Avish, welcome to Snacky Tunes. Thank you for taking the time out of your schedule. Today's a busy day because it is the morning before the LA Times 101 Best Restaurant list is announced tonight. So I know you'll be at the event. I know you're waiting for that ranking to come out. So we are thankful for you making the time.
Of course. We're excited. Thank you for having us.
Let's not bury the lead. Congratulations, Pijja Palace, Eaters LA Restaurant of the Year. Also on the Michelin Bib Gourmand list. How do you feel? What do these accolades mean to you?
It feels great to be recognized in the company that we're recognized in. It's cool, man. I don't think that, especially as a sports bar, I don't know that there's been a lot of sports bars that have been recognized in Michelin or as a restaurant of the year. So that's kind of cool.
I would say probably outside of the UK, you probably don't get like a lot of, like the UK gets a couple of like pubs that get grandfathered in. But in America, right. I definitely can't say of another like casual sports bar vibey place that's gotten that level of accolade.
Wow, that's a thing though? I gotta look, you just put me on to something. Like I gotta look up the London history now.
Oh yeah, 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 yeah. Every once in a while, London gets, you know, some of the places that have like been around for a while.
Okay, word.
You know, there was this line in the original Eater review about your commitment to delivering a dining experience that no one really asked for, which I thought is pretty amazing because in some ways, you know, this industry is so tough as it is. But I feel like people are like, oh, I'm just going to go out and do the same thing and try and recreate the success of something that already exists, but maybe seen through their own filter. You created something that was pretty unique, which I think is sort of fundamentally at the core of your success. But what did you want to do? What did you want to say in starting the restaurant?
Well, I don't know that I set out to say anything. Like we didn't know when we opened Pijja Palace, I was relatively unknown. Nobody knew who the fuck Miles was. Like we were just like two guys who just, you know, Miles was coming off being a sous chef at Roberta's, and like I was opening up my first restaurant and staffing was really difficult. It was a weird period of time, but I just wanted to open up a sports bar with great food. I like sports bars. I like growing up in LA, you know, there's so many great sports teams. Even this year, like when the Lakers are down, when the Dodgers are down, like even LAFC won something. So it's just like so cool.
Yeah.
Yeah. Love it. It's just, I don't know. I just wanted to do something like sports oriented. Everything that happened after that, kind of crazy. But yeah, I also, you know what? I also feel like you're right when you said that like a lot of people tend to like just do the same stuff that's been around for like decades. Mm-hmm. I think this is the easiest industry to succeed by doing something different. But I think that like, where the industry, like they kind of train you to do the same shit over again. Like culinary school changed for fucking years. We're still like, when was the last time you and your boys were like, let's go out and get a Coq au Vin?
Last night, you know, I was like, let's go get some mother sauces. Let's do some like Eurocentric dining. Yeah.
I think culinary school hasn't changed in a while. And even restaurant management school, like they use like national statistics, which just kind of blows my mind. Like, I learned a lot at ICE and I'm grateful for everything that they taught me, but it was just a lot of like just they train in you to not be the exception when I'm just like, okay, fuck all this. Like, what can we do to be different?
Well, I mean, let's just start with the idea of a sports bar, which I mean, to be honest, like 2 years ago, in the middle of the pandemic, the idea of getting together and watching sports, which to me, you know, it's like I never watched more sports in my life than during the pandemic. Like that's when I really think I became like a Dodgers fan during like the short season where I watched. Oh, yeah. I was like, I can watch all 60 games. I'm just sitting at home. And so the idea of having this like communal experience was wild then. And, you know, having gone in and especially now it's, you know, the World Cup and you're like, oh, sports are like back and it's very like, let's congregate.
Yes.
But even the idea of opening up a sports bar is something you don't hear a lot about. It's not something that you really hear about, especially for those who aren't familiar with Silver Lake, like in the super hip part of a town. What was the original idea behind the concept? Like, what made you want to open a sports bar?
I just, man, it's just this, I grew up like into sports. Like I grew up like my I go into like the family barbecues. So much of what my youth was just like going to the family barbecues and like sports would be on, everything was centered around sports. Even Julio's was like a big part of my childhood in Cerritos. It's it's basically an Indian sports bar. I guess there probably would be no Pijja Palace without Julio's. Pizza. It's just like, I was hell bent on opening up a sports bar. I wanted to go to a place, watch the game where the floors weren't sticky, where the room wasn't dark, where the food was phenomenal. And like where the beverages were like craft, you know what I'm saying? Like Crown and Coke and like well bar cocktails are cool, but I just wanted to like have a cool tailored experience and just watch the game, you know, like just we're all there to just like cheer for our team. Like it's a happy, good time. Like I tried to push out, like, you know, don't come into the restaurant to think, like come in, have a good time.
Yeah. I like that approach because a lot of the new restaurants that open it is you're coming in for the experience of what's contained within the restaurant. And there's no acknowledgement of the outside world, not in a bad way, but it's like you're coming here for the conversation, for the focus, the things like that. And intrinsically your place is like, no, we are nodding to like what is going on outside this world, because that's a core tenet of who we are, and it's just going to create a different experience.
Right.
I also think the restaurant's a good example of these types of menus or cuisines that came out of the pandemic that feel super unique, but are really rooted in like a personal story or personal culinary history. How personal is this restaurant to you?
Entirely. I mean, I don't know how much of it outside of like, I mean, even like it's 110% personal. Even the new dishes we come, even though like, you know, we have multiple minds in the kitchen now, like it's all just us developing together. The project's super personal, you know, like Pijja Palace is like what I've worked so hard for over the last decade. Like even if I wasn't working on Pijja Palace particularly, like all of this was driving towards the restaurant in some capacity. Like,
I mean, you have a unique background in the restaurant industry. You went to culinary school. You have worked in a bunch of different restaurants. And you just alluded to the fact, like, there's always in the back of your mind. Did you have some idea of opening up a place from the get-go? Did you know that you wanted to eventually have all roads lead to this spot? Or how did this idea come together over the years? Where did you pull different little snippets from?
Yeah, so definitely wanted to open up my own restaurant. I don't think anybody goes to culinary school if they don't want to open up a restaurant or like be an executive chef one day. Did that. Did my externship in a fine dining restaurant. Worked in like Indian fine dining for quite some time, and like I just like didn't like it. Like I liked the food, but I just didn't like all the like foo-foo shit and like looking into the dining room. And, like, yeah, dude, just like seeing like people in suits and like talking about stocks. And I was just like in the kitchen, like, man, these guys do not give a fuck about us. Like, what are we doing here? Like, this is just so stupid. And I'm like picking petals and like fucking peeling onions. And like, it just felt so soulless. And like, it just wasn't for me. Like, And there was like a serious time where I was like, man, did I fuck up here? Like, is this the career for me? And then, you know, I just kept thinking about like, okay, like I like Indian food. How can I do something that's still comprehensive, but like more casual? And I wanted to open up a restaurant where like, it's still fun for the cooks. Like we get to come here, we get to think about the dishes, think about like bringing things together. But like people who come into the restaurant, don't feel bad singing happy birthday to somebody if it's their birthday, you know, like, and people are more into March Madness brackets than like stocks or Bitcoin or whatever.
Oh man, we don't need to talk about Bitcoin on this. And I would say that if at some point, if you work in food or tangential to food and you haven't thought, have I made the wrong decision and completely fucked up my life and my career, then you're probably not going to find success. I feel like that is an underlying push. Yeah, there is definitely this vibe when you walk into the restaurant that I felt had been lost in some of the places where it's not so much a scene to be seen, but just a place to go enjoy yourself. And as rudimentary as that sounds, you know, and part of it I do think was because of the pandemic and all of us not eating out together, but just the idea of going out and being like, we're just going to go watch a game together. Like we're all going to share in this thing that we could really just do in our homes alone is really refreshing.
Yeah. Well, I kind of also wanted it to feel like just one big ass living room. I mean,
yes,
I'll talk to people in the dining room like they're my friends or like I've known them all my life. Like I throw out all the like management handbook bullshit. Like I'll just be like, yo brother, like you're not supposed to, like they teach you all this shit, like you're not supposed to like gender like assume somebody's gender, but I'll do it anyway. I'll be like, yo brother, what's up, like, you know. And if they get corrected, I get corrected, but I'm just talking to people like I would if they were my friends. Like I'll swear not at people, but I'd be like, yo man, did you see that fucking play? Like crazy. Like, oh, like I'll tap people on the back. Like, I just wanted to feel like, you know, we're like everybody in the restaurant is, I just think about hospitality differently, you know, like I don't think there's a standard for how staff needs to interact with guests. I just wanted to feel like Pijja Palace.
I think if you wrap it up in a different presentation and you say like it's a sports bar and we're still, it's like a Trojan horse type of way of where you have a sports bar and you're like, go in, it's super casual, but you get in there and you're like, oh, the food's great and the drinks are great and the vibe's great and the management is great. And it's coming from like someone who actually studied this craft. And then you're saying, this is how we're going to try it. And if I get things wrong, they get things wrong. But if I get things right, then it'll feel more authentic or more real to who I am, then people keep coming back and it's a different type of experience.
Yeah. I hope people feel like that. I hope though it's casual, people come in there and feel like we're like, I did put a lot of effort and work into it. And when things do go wrong, like not all of the dishes, I don't know when you came into dine, but I don't know if like me and Miles and Cameron, we're always talking about like how we can change the menu. Like we knew that not everything was going to hit. Like we made up fucking every dish on the menu. So like we knew not everything was going to hit. So immediately, like when we start getting feedback on Resi or whatever, we get together and we're like, okay, this needs to change. How do we fix this? How do we edit this? And it's just that process in itself is just fun as well.
Yeah. All right. Let's take a quick musical break because I definitely want to get into the food and the process and how you approached it. We have a song from the archives here on Snacky Tunes on Heritage Radio Network.
Pushing me away from you, and there's nothing I can do, and I can't fight all of your battles for you. You're pushing me away from you, oh, and I know what I'll do. I'll hop the fence so I can get out of this mess. Oh, oh. You're pushing me away from you, and there's nothing I can do. And I can't fight all of your battles for you. You're pushing me away from you, oh, and I know what I'll do. Yeah, I know what I'll do. I know what I'll do. I'll get you out my mind.
Welcome back to Snacky Tunes. We are here with Avish Naran of Pijja Palace. And, you know, there's always this ongoing conversation and chat about authentic food or authentic approach to food and cooking. And, you know, you grew up in a house that was multi-generational and had two grandmothers who cooked two different types of Indian food. Like, and you know, you look at this cuisine that is so broad and so vast and has so many different interpretations, and then people come in when you try and do something new and they go like, that's not authentic, that's not this type of cuisine. But I feel like, and again, I know we talked about this a little bit in Act One, that like this is really what the new types of restaurants are like, where it's like, this is my experience, like it's rooted in something that I grew up with. It's rooted in these spices and these flavors, but I'm going to apply it in the way that I want to apply it, and it's still going to be real to me. What you've done is create a very new type of cuisine. And you knew that at some point when you put this out, people were going to have their opinions on it, good or bad. How did you approach developing the menu, and how did you, or were you aware that people were going to have a lot to say about what you were creating when you put this menu out?
So first and foremost, there wasn't like a linear pathway to how we got to every dish. I can't say, yeah, some of the dishes came together as quickly as like Miles would be in the grocery store and he'd be like, man, Indian eggplant's really cheap. Should we do an eggplant curry pasta? And I'd be like, dude, we should do an eggplant curry pasta. Or like, I'd be at the car wash and be like, man, dude, like vodka sauce is really popping. Like we should try doing an Indian version of it or something like that. Like there was no linear pathway. Some dishes were inspired by other restaurants. Shout out to La Ventina's Pizza in Lakewood. The original chutney pizza. To do our own chutney pizza, so we did that. I really like bar pie. Jersey style bar pie is one of my favorite things, so we use that as a vessel for a lot of our Indian flavors, because there's also not a lot of, like, save for the fact that it's Indian pizza, like we're very specific in our style of pizza. There isn't a lot of bar pie in LA. I don't even know if there is any bar pie in LA, honestly.
Look, I'm sure there is some weekend pop-up bar pie, you know, probably, or some tavern style pizza. But yeah, no, it's a very East Coast style, because I grew up in Philadelphia and Jersey, New York. I was in the area. I was like, oh, I recognize this style. I was like, this is refreshing because I haven't seen this a lot in LA.
Right.
I mean, you are using a lot of onion rings, wings, pizza, you know, using a lot of like well-known delivery formats for different types of flavors. How did the process work working with Miles? Because you definitely had a vision. You definitely have, you know, this really good relationship, which isn't always the case where someone can have this free form back and forth. But I do think like that style of like creative development, especially when doing a new menu, a new concept, can really lead to new creations. But how does it, I know you mentioned like, oh, I have an idea, you have an idea, but like, what's the deeper process? What's the deeper trust between you two?
First of all, shout out to Miles. There's no way in hell we would be anywhere here without Miles. And also like there were plenty of executive chefs who, when I was opening Pijja Palace and we were seeking out a chef, like there were 15 people who were just like, fuck off, this is not going to work. Like, and we literally have messages like, dude, this concept is not going to work. And then Miles came in. He was introduced to us by Duncan, who's a mutual friend. He's a consultant at New School. I was starting to lose hope too. Like, God damn, what am I going to do here? Cause like I cook a little, and I obviously went to culinary school, but I can't run a kitchen. Like there's also just like the element of before I went to culinary school, I was in design school. So a lot of the artistic stuff I like to do myself. But yeah, like we finally got Miles, and like he accepted the challenge. I mean, like they don't teach Indian food in culinary school, and like nobody ever willingly works at an Indian restaurant who's gone to culinary school. And he was like, you know, this sounds intriguing. And he had a pasta and pizza background coming from Roberta's. And so a lot of those first couple like weeks were us just in the lab, like trying to figure out what works. And he's like a very agreeable guy. Both of us are like, we're good, like way of checks and balances, like pitching things off. And like, I also want to just say that like Cameron has been phenomenal for us. Who's our sous chef. Indian. And I mean, he's Pakistani and white. So like, a lot of the flavors that he brings are similar to the stuff that I grew up cooking and eating as well. The Nahari dish, for instance, is a combination of all the stuff the Nihari sauce itself is his. And then Miles did all the accoutrements and stuff like that. Like he's been great. Some of the chutneys are his. Enough credit can't go to the team. They're great.
Yeah. I mean, I don't think you get a spot like this or you don't have a menu like this without a team behind it. You alluded to it earlier as well, is that you've had dishes that have missed. But you're also willing to put dishes on the menu that you know aren't going to work, which, let's be honest, like in a razor thin margin world of this food, how do you approach that from a business point of view, knowing that you're going to have misses? Is it, we know that if we move enough onion rings and old fashions, we can cover a couple of specials. Where does that risk management come in?
I think it's just in quick adjustment. Like if we see something start to fail, we're like, okay, fucking everybody in the war room right now. Like let's, what do we do here? We'll experiment. We never think anything's going to fail. Right. Like we'll all taste it.
Sure.
Yeah. And then like, when we see the public be like, okay, this is fucked up. Then we'll be like, okay, this is fucked up maybe. And then we got to switch it up. And then we go from there. But yeah. At the end of the day, like it is a pizza pasta concept, so it's not like we're losing like T-bone steak money. I'm not trying to sound like a douchebag, but we have a little bit of money to play with.
No. It's you're not like you're like the truffles went rotten. No.
We'll try to fix it quick. Like if something goes bad, we'll be like, okay, let's talk about this. And then we'll come up with something new.
You know, it just, the thing about this restaurant is when you look at sort of the national dining scene, it really does feel like something you could really only do in LA. And there's something about it because it's postmodern in some approach, but then it makes total sense in the landscape of this
city. And when you see it now, you're like, oh yeah, this seems natural that a place like this would exist. But you broke a mold in many ways. And once you broke the mold and you were, let's be honest, like pretty popular from the day the doors opened. I know I'm sure there's like a couple of weeks where you're like, is anyone really going to crowd us in? But when I was there on a Tuesday night, it was line out the door, people waiting.
First 2 weeks were rocky.
Oh, I'm so sorry that the first 2 weeks.
Well, I was dying. I was like, I make a mistake. I was like, oh shit, I better apply to college again. Like, when are the FAFSA deadlines due? Like, I gotta go.
Yeah. When do I tell my parents that maybe this gamble didn't work? But now that you've established yourself, now that you have this place in LA that feels very, very well suited to the landscape, is it allowing you to push yourself to go further, to keep taking more risks, to keep trying new things, to keep pushing the boundaries of what you can serve and what you can offer?
Of course. I don't think there's a world I succeed without pushing the boundaries a little bit. Like, I'm not Indian enough to be on the level of like straight Indian chefs cooking Indian food. They've been doing this shit all their life. All the Indian restaurants in America have Indian cooks who have moved here, right? Like,
sure,
there aren't people my age cooking Indian food, right? Is there?
I don't know. I mean, I assume that there's I mean, look, I think that there is probably a heritage or lineage play where people take over some of the really good restaurants. But yeah, I mean, I will admit I don't know enough of the kitchens of like who is 30 or 40 who's saying like, I want to open up a traditional spot.
Right. This is true. And I just feel like the best lane for us is just playing our game. Like, I don't know how to do anything else. Like, it's also just uninteresting to me to do the same thing that other people are doing. Like, it blows my mind, actually. Like, motherfuckers will go through the effort of going through culinary school and like working for 10 years. And then they're like, you know what I need to do? I need to open up a restaurant and we got to serve cacio e pepe. I'm like, you could literally Google, like, they teach you how to do that on YouTube. Like, you could just figure out how to make, it's just crazy. Like, I just don't understand like how you can work for 15 years and then just do something that's already out there. Like, that's just a me thing though.
Well, I mean, you did say, you know, you view the restaurant as an art project.
And I did say that.
Which I loved, because if you put the restaurant through that lens, it makes a lot more sense, where you're like, I'm going to pull these different materials, this different palette, and they're all familiar on their own, but I'm going to make something new. Can you expand on this concept and what it means to you as an art project, and how has it evolved since it's opened?
I don't know. I just get really particular about like restaurant stuff. I don't really do shit else. I just love restaurants. Like, I just love going to them. Like, I spent the last week in New York and I was just like enamored by like how Daniel Myers Jr. Hospitality Group moves. Like, just the way that the staff is trained. And then also the Unapologetic Food Squad, the Damaka, Ada team, everything they touch turns to gold, man. Shout out to them. And then even like Double Chicken Please and like the way they approach like creating cocktails. I go into every restaurant like just looking at like stuff like that. And I also have like a creative background going to design school and working for like a gender show and a couple like clothing brands. So like, the art part of it, like making our own custom pasta dye with the rickshaw and like doing some of the Pijja Palace hand lettering and stuff. Like, I just find some of that stuff so interesting. And like, even like fitting into that Venn diagram that Pijja Palace tries to fit into, it's like making it approachable for diners who just walk in off the street, but also like people who have like fine dining, who are just eating at like, you know, like fine dining restaurants all the time, but also like doing something that's Indian enough where like people still feel like, okay, he's doing something that feels Indian, but also like people who are American are like, this is vessel is something we know, like we're not scared to walk in and try it. It's just like always trying to fit in the middle of something that I enjoy, like it's fun. It's genuinely fun. And I hope my staff feels like that as well. Like,
yeah. Well, I mean, it feels fun and that art project and that pushing it. I mean, I don't know a lot of sports bars in general who have machined their own dye for pushing out pasta. You know what I mean?
That's what my eventual goal is, for all the sports bars to have their own pasta dyes.
Yeah. Well, Avish, congratulations on everything. If people want to check out the restaurant, follow along in the story, see what new specials pop up on the menu, where can they go? Where can they check things out?
They can find us on Instagram. You can follow us on Instagram. We're working on a couple other things. And then just come visit the restaurant, you know?
Amazing. Well, listen, thank you for making the time. Looking forward to seeing you tonight and looking forward to coming back in. I'm sure you're going to be jammed as the World Cup ramps up even more.
That'd be great. You think we're going to make the list?
Do I think you're going to make the list?
Yeah.
I mean, yes.
Dope. Over or under 50? We'll make a shot bet.
I would say under 50.
Okay. Right, under meaning 1 through 50 or 50 through 100?
Well, technically 1 through 49. Or I guess you could say 1 through 50 if you want to just get in there at the fives. What do you think?
I would be happy to make it on the list. I'm going to say probably 50 through 100 because like this is a – like there are restaurants on there who have to make it, right? Like people who are just – Spago is going to be on the list obviously, like, you know.
I mean, look, go back and listen to, you know, we had Bill Addison on just a few weeks ago. You can go back and listen to that that chat and his approach. I don't know. In the rankings are back, baby. So that was, you know, we'll see. You know, look, there's, I don't know how many thousand restaurants in LA and however far they expand to consider LA. So I think to your point, just being on the list.
Yeah.
But then you get on the list and you're like, wait, where are we on the list? Wait, where's that number? I don't know.
I'm gonna be like, bro, you owe me a shot.
All right. We'll make good on that. My. So we both say yes. I'm saying 1 through 50. You're saying 50+. All right.
Yeah.
I'll come in. We'll do onion rings and a shot.
Fair.
All right, Avish. Congratulations on everything again. Congratulations on the Eater Award, the Michelin Award, everything like that. The list, and we have another song from the archives and a live performance here on Snacky Tunes on Heritage Radio Network.
Appreciate you, brother.
Color.
Keep Nonprofit Food Radio on the air and get a limited release HRN t-shirt designed by artist Chema Scandal. When you become an HRN member or renew your existing membership at the $90 level, you'll receive a shirt created exclusively for members as our thank you gift. Don't wait, because this limited edition t-shirt is only available until December 31st. Go to heritageradionetwork.org/donate to support HRN at any level. There's more swag and benefits available for any tax-deductible donation. You can even get your company on the HRN airwaves as a perk of our business membership program. Head to heritageradionetwork.org/donate.
We have CJ Fly live in studio. CJ, welcome to the show.
Thanks for having me. What's up, bro?
Thanks for being here. You were born to Jamaican and Barbadian parents.
Yes, sir.
How did that influence you growing up, and what did you pull from each of their cultures that you can determine?
Well, it basically made me into like this almost, I don't want to call myself superhuman, but like, you know. You can
call yourself that.
Yeah, all right, cool. Superhuman, you know. It makes me like, my parents are like two cool West Indian parents, you know. So to take both like both of their like cultures and their swags to make me is like an amazing thing, you know.
I like to look at my parents and pick out their best traits. And when I see like it's something poor inside of me, yeah. I was like, well, I'm not like that side of that.
Yeah.
So what are some of the more defining qualities that you took from your mom and from your dad's side that influenced your work and kind of your drive?
Well, growing up, my dad only played reggae. You feel me? Like, people like are shocked to know that I wasn't raised on like Wu-Tang and Tribe, you know. I found out about a lot of that stuff from my own. My mom's being from Barbados. She's like raised on soca and calypso music. And that was her upbringing. So she like introduced me to that world too.
I don't know if it's that surprising. I think a lot of artists, you think because of the music that they make, that's what they grew up listening to. Mm-hmm. But I think that you'll find the ones that truly define themselves and have a certain something special, it's because they're specifically not raised on that music.
For sure.
And have those outside influences and then find their own thing. But it's always run through the filter of like, I want to go back to what I know from growing up.
For sure. I'm basically like, I'm a Brooklynite. So I'm a product of my environment. You know, Brooklyn is like the mecca of hip hop. You know, New York is one of the places that people recognize lyricists for, like, you know, so it's like me being from here and then having the mixture of that is a mixture of those both flavors, you know. People don't even know hip hop was started, like, from, like, I think, in my opinion, Jamaicans, you know, DJ Kool Herc, mm-hmm. a Jamaican guy who came to New York and made his own wave, you know.
So who from your dad's side, we'll start there first, did he really play for you growing up and has stuck with you through all the years?
One of my favorite artists of all time is Pijja Montan. Free him. He's in jail right now. Barris Hammond. Sizzla, Capleton, like a lot of the more old school reggae stuff, not like newer stuff. He did play the newer stuff like Vibes Cartel, Bounty Killer, and all those guys, but like that was the main like thing, like right there, like his generation of reggae, you know? Bob Marley, those things, you know?
Mm-hmm. And from your mom's side, who did she listen to?
My mom is weird. She listened to her soca and calypso music, and then she had a mixture of like R&B, not rap. So she had like some Allison Hines, like Rupi and a couple other artists and stuff like that. And then my mom would like listen to like Jaheim and Jagged Edge and like all of those things mixed with that, you know what I'm saying? So,
and did they incur, or who got control of the stereo?
Well, my parents were never together.
Okay.
So it was two separate type of experiences, you know, a different vibe. Like even my grandmother's house, like her food would be like the whole Bajan side of it. And my dad's side would be like curry, oxtails, all that type of stuff, you know?
Do you have a preference now, or is there one? Do you have one specific? Is there like a favorite dish from one side and a favorite dish from another side?
Yeah, for sure. My mom, she loves this dish called kuku. It's like cornmeal mixed with like some vegetables and some other things, and they cook it with like sides, like flying fish, and it's cool. I like that a lot.
What's flying fish?
A fish that literally flies.
Oh,
out it the is, water.
Like it's not like a clever name. It's literally just
no,
a flying
it literally
fish.
Flies. Okay, you go to Barbados, you'll see that motherfucker jump out the water, like keep jumping. So. Flying fish is one of my favorites from Barbados. They have fish cakes too. I have like three favorite Barbados dishes, like flying fish, fish cakes, and like maybe the cuckoo, you know.
Can you taste the difference because the fish is aerated?
It's not actually flying, like it just jumps out of the water for a little bit, like on some sandwich, you know.
But over its lifetime, it's still out of the water more than most fish.
Possibly, yeah. That's why it's a flying fish. Yeah. You know, flop.
And then from your dad's side, what dishes?
I love stew peas, which is oxtail, mm-hmm. and with red peas in it. I love jerk chicken. Anything jerk, I love. I love spicy foods, you know. And what else? Ackee and saltfish, which is the national dish from Jamaica.
And what is that?
It's basically like this plant. It's like yellow and it has like black seeds in it. That's the ackee. Saltfish is basically codfish. I don't know if you ever had that. Mm-hmm. They basically mix those two together and put like some pepper in it, and it becomes this like beige and yellow mixture with peppers, and it's just beautiful, man. It's like art.
And have they taught you any of the dishes themselves? Do you cook?
A little bit. They haven't taught me like the super nice things that I like yet, you know, because they obviously, I think my dad especially, he wants to cook for me still, like, so he doesn't want me to like not need him anymore.
I mean, I feel like those dishes, especially in national heritage dishes, like tortilla from Spain,
yeah,
they're so simple, mm-hmm. but it takes 200 times for you to go from your first try, which is fine,
yeah.
to, okay, this has all the history, all the nuances, all the, you have to know that at the 33 minute, you got to do this one thing.
For sure. I suck cooking rice. Like,
yeah.
I just bought a rice maker the other day.
Okay.
So me making rice is not a successful thing right now, but like.
I feel like maybe with the parents, or my mom makes a lot of dishes, but what she makes the best is jam. And it's
Jam? What?
From jam. And it's simple. It's just sugar, lemon, and the fruit itself. So really simple, but the most easy thing to mess up because it's just so simple. Mm. So it takes, you know, sitting with her all the hours to cook it just to make sure it's like, okay, you got to look for this. You got to do this stuff.
That's tight.
So maybe you can go back to your dad and be like, look, you can still cook for me. It's going to take a lot of hours between now and then, but
for sure.
But don't wait till it's too late for me to learn the subtlety. That's what
I
would
say. For sure. It's like, I definitely want to learn how to cook all of these Jamaican dishes because I plan to move to the West Coast one day. My dad doesn't live over there. So it's like, I need to be able to survive somehow.
Well, now you just screwed up because you told him he's your anchor food now. He's like, you can't move to the West Coast until I teach you.
No, literally, until I find like actual restaurants I like out there too. You know, Sweet Chick's about to go out there, so I'll be fine.
Yeah, and then from Brooklyn itself, what are the dishes that you had growing up that defined your childhood that are not from the parents' side?
Jerk chicken patties from Golden Crust.
Mm.
Jerk chicken from like the jerk spot on Nostrand and Church Avenue. Roti, you know about roti?
Mm-hmm.
Roti. What else? I don't know, man.
And then what's the spice level that you can hit? And what are the spice levels of the different cuisines? Are mom and dad the same, or is it a varying degree?
Well, let's just fact check. My mom doesn't cook herself.
Mom doesn't cook. Grandma.
My auntie.
Oh, your auntie cooks. Yeah. Okay.
So, but they have their own like hot sauce, too, which is like some weird yellow hot sauce with like peppers in it.
Mm-hmm.
That's pretty hot. And then there's Jamaican hot sauce, like Grace's hot sauce, which is pretty hot, but it's like more like on the acidic side and spicy. And then so I think they both like have like their own spice levels, but for me, I can't go to the super painful like lip and tongue infuriating pain spices, you know. So I think it's mainly like jerk and from there back, you know?
Right. So you can still have the spice, but also taste the food underneath.
Yeah.
I've never been able to go to that insane part because then you're just eating something covered in.
It's too much.
It's too much.
It's too intense. Food shouldn't be intense. It should be like more of a comfortable thing.
Yeah.
You should be like very happy to eat food.
And you can just ease into the spice levels. You get think of something to work towards. It's not a game.
Yeah, for sure.
Can we hear a song?
Yeah, I got you.
What are you going to play first?
Let's do Now You Know, my single that's out right now.
Okay, yeah. from the new record.
Yeah, Flytrap.
Okay, great.
December 9th.
All right, live on Snacky Tunes.
Flytrap coming soon, December 9th. Hope you hear this and you know. 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 Now you know you fucked up. Cause a nigga lucked up. Now you really look dumb, tell me how that shit go, tell me how that shit go. Now you know you fucked up, cause a nigga looked up. Now you really look dumb, tell me how that shit go, tell me how that shit go.
Seen too many niggas switch sides, getting tired of the dick riding you. Lukewarm, I'm John Blaze, my shit's fire. Either in the stool or I'm getting high. I don't make a lie, but I'm getting by. I know I sin, but a nigga try. I could roll this weed in a nigga time. Tell me break it down, smell it with a prime. Only 22, so I'm in my prime. Made it here without committing crimes. Making paper off some different lines. Took my life and put it in these rhymes. Transformation like a Megatron. Give my music everything I got, and I don't think that I ever stop. A leader, you don't catch me with a fuck. Some people say that I'm a witty fool. Why the hell a nigga quitting fuck? Gotta get a mention to put in my folks. I just gotta make a bigger quote. I just gotta make a bigger quote. Now you know you fucked up. Cause a nigga looked up. Now you really look dumb. Tell me how the shit go. Tell me how the shit go. Now you know you fucked up. Cause a nigga looked up. Now you really look dumb. Tell me how the shit go. Tell me how the shit go. Hope you hear this and you know. 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 Fly track.
You started writing poetry when you were in fourth grade. Yeah. Does any of that still carry over?
Yeah, it does, because when I learned to write poetry, I was learning to write cursive too. And I can remember that exact moment of my dad being like, your handwriting is deplorable. You know, so I remember writing rhymes and shit like that. And he'll be like, yo, I can't even read this chicken scratch. But in my mind, it was always like, I can read it, you know? Right. That's all that mattered to me, me being able to read my own words. So from there on, like, I started writing poetry and that developed and turned into rap music.
Have you gone back and looked at the early works?
I don't even know where it is. I'm sure my dad has like so many backpacks in his closet, but like we had a flood once and it messed up like a lot of my old school books and stuff. So a lot of my old archive stuff got damaged through like damages, like damage.
I mean, it's like going back and reading, you probably thought it was so great then, and it might be pretty painful now to go to go and do it.
It's funny, man. I my cousin always says to me like, yo, you remember your old raps? And I'm like, yeah, but I remember my cousin telling me, like, he didn't get them then, you know? So I'm sure there'll be some type of, like, gem within that.
Right. You're like, there's one line out of all the notebooks that we'll just carry for, like, 20 years.
Of course, yeah. Because even people come up to me now and say, like, my verse on, like, Hard Knock with Joey is one of my best. And that was such a young me that didn't know anything. Mm-hmm. So it's crazy to me that they think, like, the youthful version of me was, like, more, like, you know?
Some people talk about the creative process as just coming from nowhere. Like, you don't have a choice.
Exactly. Natural. The universe wanted it to happen.
So did anyone around you, I mean, obviously you grew up in Brooklyn, so you were surrounded by hip-hop, but poetry is a distinct difference between rapping and writing lyrics. So where do you think, or do you have any sense, and you can say just came, where the poetry started from before it evolved into writing lyrics?
I think I've always been very expressive as far as, like, writing goes. I'm an only child, so like me being an only child influenced me to try to communicate through my music. You know, I didn't really grow up with anybody to communicate with, so my music is the tool I have and use to basically speak to the world, you know. So with that being said, yeah, through me like trying to like get my message and get my story out there, basically, like, I feel like I took poetry and used it as a platform, you know. And I think even through the reggae, I heard the lyrics and I knew that was poetry in itself, you know, like Baris Hammond and Buju Banton, they were like poets of their own culture, you know, speaking of their story and the story of their country. So I wanted to do the same. And I think it started from that timing, you know, just understanding words from my parents playing it, you know.
And how did the evolution in your own mind go from writing poetry to writing lyrics? Or where did you begin to see the shift? This is a poem, but now this is definitely a lyric.
I feel like before I was way more like writing poetry. I was writing poetry more on a emotional tip. So putting my emotions into the sheet of paper, you know? Now it's more of a topic or a target audience I want to tap into and make a song for that specifically, you know? Then it was just like me writing a poem for myself. Now I'm writing lyrics for the world.
And did the poetry and the lyrics get you into the performance arts high school?
Nah, actually, went to school for communication arts.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, so everybody else was going there for, like, acting and, like, other programs and shit. But I was literally there for like communication arts only. And
what is communication arts?
I couldn't tell you. Just a fancy name for nothing.
Nothing. But like, that's where you met your entire clique.
Yeah, basically. We went to high school together and we were all ciphering in the hallways together and shit. And obviously, like when like let's say 10 people are rapping, you know the three that are nice. You know what I'm saying? That was our energy. And we always like chill with each other. And we had like a similar goal to be the best, you know? Like I didn't learn about entendres and stuff like that until I met Steez and all the rest of the homies, you know?
And were you still at a young enough age where you were allowed to be vulnerable and ask questions? Like, how did the education process happen? I mean, we're talking about high school, so you think 16, 17 is not that old, but still at that age, within any situation, you want to sometimes act as much. But did you have a certain persona in the hallways? And then you'd be like, okay, what'd you mean behind closed doors? Or how did the formation take place?
As far as the crew?
Yeah.
We were cutting class together. So after the ciphers and all that, we was like, okay, these are the guys, you know? You identify everybody as artists, you know? And then you see who you mesh with perfectly and who meshes with everybody else well, too. Because there were some people that could have been in the crew, but they didn't mesh well with everybody else. They had, like, personal whatever problems, you know what I'm saying? So we just clicked instantly. We all used to cut class together and create. We try to record, like, in the auditorium. Like, we were just doing everything we shouldn't have been doing just to create. And now there's a program at our school for making music, which is dope because of us, you know? And that's dope that we have that program there, like, because we used to cut class just to do what we had to do, so... It started through that, and then we just started building, and years passed, and everything just blew off and took off.
What was the first show together like?
The first show together was crazy. I think the homies had another show that I wasn't at, and that solidified it, and then the next show was, like, crazy. Like, we went on a tour that summer. It was insane, man. Like, a lot of magic. Like, we just knew it was something special. It wasn't, like, a random feeling, you know?
You don't need to give, like, the best story, because you can keep that thing, but what's, like, the second best story from that
tour? Second best story from the tour? Damn. I mean, it was three, like, 17, 16, 18-year-old kids just traveling around America, just touring for the first time, seeing people, like, react great to us. So, like, there was so many things. We shroom-tripped on that tour. Like, that was a crazy timing, you know. It was dope to see the fans react to us the way they did for our first time, you know. So.
And where did you get the name Progressive Era from, or how did that come about? Naming is difficult no matter what the artistic endeavor.
For sure.
So where did that come through? And does someone lay claim to it, or is it a fuzzy, like, I think I said it, no, I think I said it?
Nah, Steez definitely came up with it, and then he asked our homie Powers what he thought about it, and then Joey and myself came next after that, and then we solidified it, you know? So, like, it was more of a school thing. Like, we were in school learning history, so, like, it was something we learned about within the 4 years we were there, and it ended up popping out as the perfect name for us, you know?
Did you feel that you had veto power by the time it got to you? Like, we want to go with this. We'll ask you, but we're really going to go with this.
I was with it. I wasn't, like, super picky. I was just more... We all didn't have our rap names now, too. Like, everybody changed their rap name a little bit, too. Like, Steez was J. Steez. Joey was J-O-V. I was, like, before I met them, I was CJ Fresh. So, like, we had to solidify ourselves, too, in addition to the group name. So, like, it was something we built on. Luckily, we knew about the whole time period, so it makes sense for us. You know what I'm saying? Definitely. Schooling.
How did you go from fresh to fly?
I mean, fresh is kind of cheesy, you know? Fly was like a term we were using, like, at the time. And, like, people were saying, like, in, like, junior high school, I remember people being like, yo, you look fresh today. And I got to high school, started switching up my style, and people started calling me Fly. And I was like, oh, this is perfect.
Oh, CJ, so Fly. The people named it for you.
Yeah, I mean, in my high school, I was known as the Fly guy. So, like, it made sense and everything connected. I used to have dreams as a kid of me just leaping off my back and starting to fly and soar. And I was like, this is perfect for me. Like, even at my mom's house in Bed-Stuy, we had, like, a plumbing problem, and the shower rod came off, and a swarm of flies comes out. And, like, I felt like Batman, bro. Before a swarm of flies comes out, I'm like, oh, man, this is meant to be. So it could have been roaches. I could have been CJ Roach, you know?
Can we hear another song?
Yeah, of course.
What are you going to play?
Italian Friendship. This is from my first mixtape.
Okay, live on Snacky Tunes.
Check. Yo, yo. Was one of the happiest fellas when I first met Bella. We started off as just friends, then exchanged love letters, became best friends, and figured there was no one better. I told her we was gonna be homies forever. You're not the type that I would often meet. More from the magazine, not on the street. Feeling like the man, but she would walk with me. Her mom is a lawyer, her daddy a cop. Got another chick on the side, but I ain't scared of her pops. She don't talk about her family a lot. When I'm with her, she love to stare at her watch. I connected the dots. Third eye squinting, cause I'm trying to see things through. Figured out what we gonna do. Kinda hungry, let's go eat some food. To Little Italy, her family spot. I'm trying to change my diet so I won't be having a lot. And older head said, when you go to sit facing the door, so you
you could gaze at the floor in case of breaking the wall. We walked in, they sat us down pronto, had a short convo, and even I know not to hurt my Italiano. She told me, get her a drink and be ready for this. I said, what? Her dad popped up and started asking for a wedding and said, let me know when I got a reverend friend. Either you get her a ring or we
get in a ring.
Her brother asked me if I wanted a slice. I told him one would be nice. I sat there hoping he ain't come with his knife. I'm in a love triangle. How did I get into this love triangle? Love triangle. Fuck it, don't give a shit. I'm infamous for having shit.
Flop.
New record, Flytrap.
Yes, sir.
Out December 9th.
Yes, sir. It's my mom's birthday.
Oh, happy birthday, Mom.
That's the significance. People don't even know that.
Well, now they do.
Yeah.
Happy birthday, Mom. Congratulations.
Thank you. Appreciate it.
What was the process of putting the new record together?
Well, I haven't put out music for the last 2 to 3 years. So it was a lot of patience, a lot of anxiety. I put all my life experiences into it. Not every single one, but like the ones that mattered for this specific project, you know? And I think people are going to like it, man. Like, it was not a long process, but it definitely took some thinking, you know?
Some people will write 50, 100 tracks, and then they'll call it down. Some people will just sit down, and the record will just come out. Were you one or the other, in the middle?
Definitely went through 50 to 100 tracks, and then I refined it down to the specific sound of cohesiveness, you know? So I definitely made those 50 to 100 tracks, and now I have 3 albums in a stash.
Okay.
So now I have some work to do, but I definitely made this project like something that was very concentrated, and the clarity is very key, and the message is there, you know?
And what would you say the message is from 3 years ago, from your last record, to what you have to say now?
Like, even at the record I just performed, that song was more like a storytelling, me trying to be on my, what's the movie called? A Bronx Tale, mm-hmm, vibe, you know? Mm-hmm. Now I'm more like my own life, my own movie. You know, that's what this project is. Like, I feel like the first mixtape, I was sitting in a movie theater with a projection coming from my eye, basically to say, like, I'm in a theater and I'm about to watch something, or you're about to watch something. And now this is one of my first films, you know? So there's a difference where I was trying to emulate other films and shit like that, and now I'm trying to do my own, like, film direction, you know?
And did you pull from your clique to be able to get reference points or to get feedback, or was this just a solo endeavor?
It was a solo endeavor, but I definitely played it for them for the last 2 years. Like, the project really changed quicker than I thought it would. Like, I thought it was done last December, and then I came back to New York. Like, last summer, I was in Canada working on it, and then I thought I was done. Came back to New York December. I'm like, this is the project. And it wasn't actually done yet. In the last, like, January to, like, August, that's when the project really completed, and I recorded so many new records and shit, so it got finished this year, and it's a different vibe from what it was before, because I actually got to figure out what I wanted to do and played it for the homies, seen their opinion, changed a few things. But I didn't ask what they thought I should do. I just did it and then said, this is what it is. You know what I'm saying?
And what was it that you thought was done and then it wasn't, just down to the bone of it?
What do you mean?
Well, what was it that you thought it was done last December, and then what did you go and back and change in the following 8 months?
I mean, I didn't feel like it was as perfectly cohesive as it is right now. I think right now, like, the clarity is key. You know, you hear every single thing and word that I'm saying and know what I'm talking about, and it all ties into each other. Before, it was more like a compilation of songs that I made in the last 2 years, which was some of my best and some of my, you know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
Different vibe joints. And now, like, I definitely pinpointed what I wanted the whole album to sound like in a whole, and I've captured that, and it's there. Flytrap.
And you have an ode to your grandfather on there.
Yes, sir.
How did that come about?
Well, last summer he passed away, rest in peace. And I was out there for the funeral, and basically I stayed with my grandmother for a month because I just felt like she needed somebody to, you know what I'm saying, lean on. And through that process, I finished like a lot of songs, like made songs for him. Like, I was sitting in the garage, and the song that I made came to me through sitting in the garage, just thinking about him, you know? So everything just came naturally through the life experiences, you know?
Did she teach you anything about cooking while you were with her?
Nah, man. It's kind of, I don't know if she's going to hear this, but it made me sad to think that, like, love is actually a factor in cooking. It kind of felt like the food tasted different since he passed away.
You hear that all the time. I don't think that's an odd statement.
No, it's true.
I think that it comes, again, it comes in that subtlety and nuance. And also, when you're cooking for people, especially if you're married for a long time, mm-hmm. you cook a certain way. You know mm-hmm. they like a little bit of this. So
exactly.
If they're not there to cook for or to guide the hand exactly. or reach for that spice,
exactly.
it does change.
That, and my grandmother's diabetic now, so she's not using as much sugar and salt and all the things she used to use. So it's a little more like... cholesterol free, you know what I'm saying?
What's going to be amazing is you're going to chase those flavors for the rest of your life.
I already know.
Well, I want to thank you for coming by the show. I want to make sure we have time for one more track. Where can people get the record? How can people find you? How can people see you live?
The record will be on all platforms, iTunes, Amazon, Google Play, Tidal, you name it. It'll be there. Definitely check it out December 9th. You might get it like a day early. We try to figure out everything, you know?
Okay. And how can people find you, book you?
You can find me on socials, Flyest in the Era, FlyestInTheEra. I'm sorry, it's so long. That was like my high school, like, mind making that Twitter account.
Yeah, and you can't change it.
I can, but the guy who has CJ Fly doesn't want to give it up.
Really?
Yeah.
I mean, that can be fixed.
Yeah, hopefully. We'll figure it out.
You just got to get bigger than him and become the authorized person.
Of course. I'm going to holler at Twitter, see what they're saying.
They can probably help.
For sure.
Well, thanks for coming by.
Thank you.
Big shout out to Darren as well out on the West Coast. Please make sure to vote for Snacky Tunes for Taste Awards. We would really appreciate it. bit.do/stvote. What are you going to take us out with?
I have this song called Diamonds that is like a record for the world. It's not just for the youth and my fans. Like, I feel like your mom might hear it and like it. So definitely play it for her.
All right. Mom, this goes out to you.
Shout out to all the mamas.
Thanks for listening. And we'll be back next week with another episode of Snacky Tunes.
No diamonds form from pressure, but don't be so hard on yourself. No diamonds form from pressure, but don't be so hard on yourself. Don't you worry about a thing, just keep shining. Show them how bright you are, even if it blinds them. If you like to dance, depending on the light, and some people see you and they get so weak. Made this one for all the minors in a dark place where you might just find us. Made it out and with a few survivors. One of their wants and their desires. What I learned and made me wiser. Cause we've been tough. Lose a lot as soon as we get cut. You know where we came from, it was rough. Hard differentiate in what is love. Feel no way if someone try to pick you up. Resilient even when they give you funny looks. Got them by their wrist just like some cuffs. Kill for you cause that's the shit that money does. Don't let your dreams get crushed. No diamonds form from pressure, but don't be so hard on yourself. No diamonds fall from pressure, but don't be so hard on yourself. No diamonds fall from pressure, but don't be so hard on yourself. No diamonds fall from pressure, but don't be so hard on yourself. You keep on shining, you keep on shining. You keep on shining, cause you are a diamond. You keep on shining, you keep on shining. You keep on shining, cause you are a diamond. You keep on shining, you keep on shining. You keep on shining, cause you are a diamond. You keep on shining, you keep on shining. You keep on shining, cause you are a diamond, diamond. Fly Trap out December 9th. Make sure you go get that. Thank you, Snacky Tunes, for having me. Fly! Forever.
We talk about food. We talk about music. With musical dudes. Finger on the pulse. Snacky Tunes.
Snacky Tunes is powered by Simplecast. Thanks for listening to Heritage Radio Network, food radio supported by you. Keep in touch at heritageradionetwork.org/subscribe.